fine.
It's a real pleasure to be able to speak to you today. And I'm glad that we sorted it out. So I write for Pulse Social Sports Group, which is like, it's a company based in London and Hertfordshire that encourages people to get involved with sport from different backgrounds and different situations. And we're writing a lot of content at the moment about like BAME sports and disability sports and the kind of barriers and what have you. So I've got a few questions, if you don't mind, that I'd sort of create a profile on you and then to get your views on some of these topics, if that's okay. Well, first of all, I was kind of wondering what got you engaged in sport and what kind of led you to become the first wheelchair racer for Kenya? Like, how did it all happen for you?
Basically, I never knew anything about sport. So after I'd had my baby, I just went to the gym to get fit.
Yeah.
Because I used to be a size 8, you know, before motherhood. And in that process, one of the trainers, a coach, an athletics coach, saw me. And he said, he's actually encouraged me to do disability sport.
Yeah.
But I didn't know what he meant until, this was the year 2002, until when I saw girls racing in the Commonwealth, 2002. The Commonwealth was held in Manchester.
Yeah.
So I saw that and I was like, ooh, I want to do wheelchair racing. And that's when we continued our conversation and they helped me get my first racing chair.
Yeah.
Then in 2004, I was able to race for Kenya.
Yeah, that was incredible because you were the first representative of Kenya, weren't you?
That is in wheelchair racing.
Yeah.
Because they were doing other different events, field events, running, you know. But in wheelchair racing, that was something different.
Yeah, of course. Mm. With a lot of BAME sports, when I've been talking to a few people, they've said that one of the biggest barriers that they feel keeps them from getting engaged with sport is like the lack of idols and the lack of representation. And I was just sort of thinking that the Paralympic funding is so starkly different to the able-bodied Olympic funding. And I was just kind of wondering what your thoughts on that, because it strikes me as very unfair.
Definitely, you know, when we talk about funding, I mean, every sport is different.
Of course.
You know, every sport is different. But when we go to, for example, funding from sponsors, you know, I think definitely an able-bodied athlete would get more money. Like, for example, 100 meters. How much did Usain Bolt earn? And maybe Usain Bolt was just training as hard, or maybe a disabled sprinter is just training as hard as Usain Bolt and maybe broken several records like Usain Bolt, but where are they when it comes to earnings, you know?
Definitely.
So there's definitely, I mean, it's not fair. There's no equality there.
No.
The able-bodied athlete is given more when it comes to more visibility, more money, bigger names, you know, they become bigger names, you know, and stuff like that than disabled athletes. I think when we speak about that, it's really, you know, some of these big brands, you know, the corporates to try and bridge that gap.
Oh, definitely. Yeah, I think it's because like a lot, I think if there's not many sort of idols like being widely broadcast who have disabilities and who are really successful athletes, it deters a lot of people who aspire to have the success that you have and other, you know, Paralympic athletes, because they're just not seeing enough of it, which I think is a problem.
Yeah, no, it's definitely a big problem. And you also asked about the, you know, the BME, you know, and that is also another thing, you know, it's... who are the best sprinters, for example, even in this country? You know, when we come to athletics, it is the, you know, the ethnic minority people who are like, you know, good sprinters. And so many of them are wearing GB kits, going out there and bringing medals back to us.
Yes.
You know, but when you talk about representation, there could be a bit of representation in some fields while so lacking in other fields. For example, dressage, you know, for example, tennis. Horse racing. There are those, you know, there are some particular sports that are still classed as very white.
Yeah, definitely.
And also, and to me, I would really like to see the BAME breaking and being given an opportunity to participate in such sports.
Yeah.
But one barrier that really holds maybe people from other backgrounds to participate in those sports, it could be money.
Yeah.
Maybe you need to buy your own horse, for example. Mm. You know? it becomes really difficult, especially if your parents are struggling, for example, you know, financially, or you're also struggling financially, and you know, stuff like that.
Yeah.
So will they put food on the table, pay rent or pay a mortgage or pay bills, or will they be saving just to buy you a horse, for example? You
yeah,
know?
Of course.
So it is because of the economic factor.
Yeah.
That some of the BMEs are not participating in certain white, you know, in quotes, white sports.
Mm. I think as well, I was recently speaking to the chair of the Muslim Sports Association, and she was saying that funding was a problem for them and a lot of other clubs like them, because they only sort of got a small budget, and they had to, and with like people paying for like classes and things, it was just the costs were really difficult. So it's hard to get BAME groups engaged and like help them succeed in those avenues.
I think it's just everywhere, because when you talk about paying for sports, you know, like every club, whether it's just predominantly a Muslim club or, you know, stuff like that, it is still, you know, even mainstream, people still have to pay. There's, you know, sometimes it's like there's membership fee that you pay. And then there's probably, if you're training twice a week, every day when you go, you're probably asked to pay £1.50 or £2 or stuff like that.
Mm.
Then there's sort of like buying running shoes and, you know, such things, or your parents working so many jobs of sacrificing to, you know, to drive you to training, you know, and stuff like that. So there are all those things that are involved that in the certain communities from actively participating in sports.
Yeah, definitely. And I think another thing that was mentioned was how, in terms of that club management, it's still very much white dominated around London, and they don't always sort of listen to the different cultural beliefs and religious beliefs when people are trying to join clubs, and that puts people off as well, because they don't feel like they've sort of got that respect that other people,
that they're listened to.
Yeah, and I think that's a huge problem as well.
I think also, you know, I think there I would probably say it's lack of knowledge on the people who are running these clubs.
Definitely.
There's lack of knowledge. And that's why if management or leadership of clubs was open to, you know, people from different backgrounds, you know, they would bring their voice, you know, they would sort of like, And I think to me, one big barrier, really, you know, when you talk about representation,
yeah,
a lot of it's based on biased beliefs.
One of my questions actually was, why do you think people still have sort of these stigmatic biased views of disabled athletes and BAME athletes? Because it's still very much out there.
Do you know? I think to me it's just lack of knowledge on those people. They're a little bit very behind.
Yeah.
With where the world is going, it's as if the world is going at a different pace from them, because they are stuck in the ways of the past.
Mm. Yeah, you know? I think with like people in like the club management, they just don't want to. They don't want to make any changes, because like, why rock the boat? You know, that's what.
Yeah, when everything else is okay, they're stuck in certain ways of doing things. And the way you're saying that, many of them are from a certain group of people. You know,
yeah,
so white, middle-aged, you know, men or women who are running things, and it's like, they will sort of still want to run these clubs the way the clubs were run during their youth. Mm. And this is like so many, many years ago. So it's sort of like trying to help these people see the vision. It's like, hey, this is the 21st century.
Exactly.
And this is where we are going. It's like, otherwise, so many of such leadership, you can never see growth in them.
No.
It is like everything is stagnant.
Yeah.
And because of that, it also becomes, it initially becomes a stumbling block or a barrier to the ethnic minority backgrounds, or people from, you know, from the ethnic minority backgrounds. But then in the long run, it catches up even with the white folks who are within that club.
Yeah.
That, you know, progression is very slow because, I mean, we're in the 21st century where people are trying different things. It's like running group, you know, try this, stretch and, you know, do this. But if you're getting a coach who is 65 and the coach will want to yell at you and scream at you because his coach yelled at them in 1960 when they were running, it is a problem.
Oh,
it is a problem when we have people running clubs in the archaic ways, you know, it's like really old-fashioned ways it's people need to be encouraged that we are in a different century where it doesn't matter your background, it doesn't matter your religion, creed, you know, your sexuality, or you know, or sex orientation.
Yeah,
we can all participate in sport.
Yeah, definitely.
If the doors are open, you know.
Yeah, I think one of the main things is like if you have diversity at the top, you'll have diversity running throughout the sort of hierarchy of like the sports clubs and things like that. Mm. So hopefully that it'll get to that.
And you know, when you talk about representation, I think to be honest, when I was told that I'm the first black person to sit on an NGB funded board, I was just like, this is not on, you know.
No.
I hope I'm not the first one and the last one. But I tell you what, I think one guy that I give credit to, his name is Ed Warner.
Mm-hmm.
He's the former chair of the UK Athletics.
All right, yeah.
And it's Ed, when I joined the board, Ed was the chair.
Right.
And I've always thought that maybe I wouldn't have joined that board if Ed wasn't there. So it was under the leadership of Ed where Ed really took a gamble.
Yeah.
And sort of said, no, we really want to grow, you know, a board member from someone, you know, of a different ethnicity, different background, a disability and all that.
Yeah, definitely.
So and I'm hoping that other people can sort of actually just learn from what he did.
Yeah, that would be good. I think if you have such a wide range of voices that represent different groups of people, it'll affect sports governance in a much more positive way than it's currently doing. I mean, it's getting better, but I think it could still get a lot better as well.
No, I know it's getting better. It's getting better, but I think the more we open up these discussions, you know, the quicker maybe, you know, we can make bigger strides. Because sometimes it's like you make 5 steps forward and then you take 3 backwards. So the journey becomes a little bit slow.
Mm.
And along the way, so many people start to drop off, you know?
Yeah. What do you think specifically would needs to change to like help people open their minds and things like that? What would you like to see sort of happen in the future?
I think one thing that I would like to see happen, Sophie, is really same consideration, same effort goes to para sport.
Mm, definitely.
You know, and you know, para sport, the way it goes to everybody.
Yeah.
Because now, you know, in this, you know, this point, I just don't want to say ethnic minority or the BME. Because those are still able-bodied, and once they come through the system, they get, you know, that's, you know, same support.
Mm.
But I think when we look at, for example, you know, certain levels, it is so difficult for, you know, people with disabilities to participate in or to take part in participation sports.
Mm. I think there's still a lot of accessibility issues.
Yeah, and this is also because there's still a lack of sufficient knowledge when it comes to coaching or, you know, supporting disabled athletes.
Yeah.
And I think this is one area where we really need to grow, you know, we need to grow the expertise in.
Yeah.
And also equipment, you know, just for some reason, when you have a disability, everything about you becomes expensive.
Mm.
I cannot just go out and get a normal bike of 600 or 1,000, you know, and start cycling.
Yeah.
My hand bike, if I needed a hand bike, that would be about 2.5, you know, starting from maybe 3 grand for me to get a cycling, you know, bike, for example. You know, it's not, you know, and I saw what Boris Johnson had said, something like, they were giving £50 vouchers, you know, to people to repair their bikes or something like that. And I was like, so where is the disabled person here? Because £50 is not even the brake on my racing chair.
Yeah,
it's not even £50 is not even the inner tube of a hand bike. Cost is a big, big thing. And I think to me, different sporting bodies, you know, all the way from grassroots to the top, this is one call that I would really like to make. They really need to put something aside to make sure that disabled people are encouraged to participate in sports.
Yeah, definitely.
You know, every region needs to do something. You know, for example, I sit on the BPA, British Paralympic Association, as a board member. They don't have a remit to help, you know, like in participation. They will look after athletes when they're going out internationally, you know, big teams, you see?
Yeah.
I sit on UK Sport, not UK Sport, UK Athletics.
Yes.
UK Athletics are really interested, not really interested, but when you look at what UK Sport does, it will be, you know, those athletes who are going out to win medals, but we've started to do participation. So the home countries will do participation. And you know who the home countries are, isn't it? Scotland, Wales, you know, blah, 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 you know. The problem is just sort of like trying to see where the priority lies, you know. I sit on an organization called Active Essex.
Yes, yes.
And I think, and Active Essex, one thing that I like about what, you know, what Active Essex is doing now, just, this is now, let's just speak about Essex. And I'm hoping there are going to be other active counties out there, you know, doing what Active Essex is doing. Because Active Essex, they have an ambassadorial, you know, like an ambassador scheme where disabled champions become ambassadors and they talk about, you know, about sport, you know, a disability sport in the county.
Yes.
And this is one way where other disabled people in the county of Essex look at these ambassadors and they see themselves, you know, all they can see, they can mirror, you know, sort of, it's just like, if so-and-so has got cerebral palsy and I've got cerebral palsy, I can try to do this. If so-and-so is visually impaired, I'm visually impaired, oh, I can go and try this.
It's open to them because someone else is succeeding with exactly the same circumstances.
Yeah, it's sort of like, if somebody else is able to make a reality, I mean, a dream, you know, come true where they can run 100 meters or they can swim, they can do this. Then when you're sitting just, you know, on your city, maybe watching the television or reading or doing things, you're like, actually, I could go out there and do something.
Yeah, definitely.
And this is one thing that I like about Active Essex because they really get what different counties need to be doing. I wish other counties would copy what Active Essex is doing.
I think it's vital, like, to get that, to have, like, these icons promoted so that more people can see the same thing, more people can see that they can get into that field because other people are doing it.
Yeah, yeah. And I think sometimes, you know, I think the onus shouldn't just be left on the NGBs who will probably concentrate on elite. We need to have these counties really rising up, you know, to the occasion and saying that we want our counties to be active. What happens when you have an you know, an active county? You know, you have an active people or an active group of people. So it will be like active or healthy people, you know, happier people, more interactive people. It will boost their social lives because they'll go out and do different activities. And I think there's that cohesion, you know, of you know, within the community when activities take place, you know. There's more love, there's more understanding and accommodating of each other's, you know, like culture, beliefs and stuff like that. And that is one thing I like about Essex. I know Essex gets a bad name sometimes to say, oh, it's Essex, you know, Essex girl and stuff like that. Well, I'm a very proud Essex girl because we are doing exploits in Essex and we are changing the narrative. You know, it's not about cheap, uneducated or what Essex. No, it's really Essex that we get where the world is going.
Yeah.
You know?
I think a lot Essex, of counties should listen to this.
Yeah, a lot of counties should really listen to what active, it's called Active Essex.
Yes. It's so crucial, I think. And I think now, especially with the pandemic going on, and people not being as active as they should be, just spreading this message is super important.
It is very important. Counties need to start supporting, you know, their people. It is very important. Active Essex is doing it. You know, with a very good strategy and all that. And UK Athletics is also doing a great thing from the top. And that is really important. But we want the counties to also start demonstrating that, you know, it's not just about giving people houses or doing this and stuff like that or collecting bins and stuff like that. That is important.
Yeah.
But also people really need to know how to keep their community active and healthy.
Yeah, definitely. I completely agree. Your like whole story is so inspiring to so many people, and you know, you continue this by being so prolific in your campaigns and the things that you're ambassador of. And I was just sort of wondering what your advice would be to sort of an aspiring disabled athlete who maybe feels sort of withheld or like a bit anxious to get involved because of their disability. Just like what would you say to them?
That's a good one. What would I say to them? I think what I would say to them is believe in yourself. You know, just have that belief that you can do it. And there's one thing I wrote on my LinkedIn, was it yesterday? I can't remember when it was. And I quoted, disabled people want opportunity, not sympathy.
Yeah, definitely.
And I think to me, that is what I would say to them. Go and grab these opportunities. If they don't come on your door, look online, you know, pick up your phone and, you know, make phone calls to clubs and sort of say, how can you integrate me in your, you know, in your activities and stuff like that.
Mm.
You know, just take that bold decision and start doing it. Meanwhile, we encourage the counties to do that. But I would say, go out there, believe in yourself, because you can do it. It's possible. Yeah. It is possible. And you may not be, you know, you may not get to the Paralympic level. You may not be a Paralympian, but you'll be a very active disabled person.
Yeah, definitely.
You know, you'll be a very active and fit disabled person in your own capacity.
Yeah, there's benefits regardless of how far you sort of climb. It's right from the beginning, there's massive benefits to your mental and physical health, which is always...
It is. I've seen people with disabilities who've gone out to start exercising, swimming, or even just going out, you know, like I know right now because of the pandemic, you know, many coffee groups stopped, you know, but there are so many people who've changed their perception of, you know, of life on, and, you know, just their perception of themselves, you know, as disabled people. And this has improved because of the interaction they've had. And some of them is just going to the gym. You know, I meet several disabled people in my gym. I haven't been for months now because of the you know, the corona. But I would meet and you'd see how these people are improving. You know, the first few days you'd see they're a little bit shy. They don't really know what is going, you know. But give them something like 3, 4, 5 months with consistency and good training. You just see them bloom to being, you know, really confident, happier people.
Yeah, sports is just fantastic on all fronts. It does so much for you. I mean, I love it.
I tell you what, you should quote me on this. You know what I say about sport? I say sport is an equalizer.
Yeah.
Sport is an equalizer. And also, sport is a universal language that we all can speak when we are given that opportunity.
Yeah. I think so. I think that speaks very true. And I think that as long as the opportunities are there, then we should keep promoting them for all people to give them this equalizing.
And that's why I sort of say that counties now need to start promoting, you know, they should copy what Active Essex is doing and mirror and sort of really get the model of Active Essex. And I tell you what, it is a model that can transform this nation.
Oh, definitely. It sounds
you know, that can transform counties.
I think the people I've been speaking to lately, there's been it's given me a bit of confidence in like equal opportunities. Like the London FA, they're doing a lot to get disabled people active. They're running a lot of football leagues, so like grassroots sports is more like equal opportunities now, and they're really listening to people when they're coaching, because I think a lot of the problem was like they thought that with disability it's one size fits all and the same advice applies to every single disability, but it's so wide, it's so much broader, and you've got to educate yourself and then provide that, but like let that come out in your coaching, and then people
exactly and that's why I say some of the some of the clubs, you know, they are not taking in disabled people because they just lack that knowledge. It's like, what will we do with them? Somebody told me that somebody said that one time their child went to try, you know, running. And the coach said, I want you to do 2 laps on the track. You know, I want you to do 2 laps of warm up. And this was someone with cerebral palsy. A cerebral palsy person cannot run 2 laps on the track, severe cerebral palsy. This was like their first time. They ran about 300 meters and they died. And then this coach said, okay, well, I cannot coach you. I can't help you. I'm sorry. That is lack of, you know, that is lack of sensitivity.
Really is.
Lack of awareness, lack of knowledge. And I call it, this is what I call ignorance.
Absolutely.
They went to somebody who was just full of ignorance. When we start to take, you know, when we start to educate counties, we will be taking out ignorance, and we will be empowering the coaches also, and we'll be empowering individuals to go out there and try sports.
Yeah, I think the way it's positive, the way that it's going. I think that the work that Essex is doing should, like you said, just be mirrored across the country, and then I think, you know, improvements will be made a lot faster. Really, you shouldn't give everyone these same criteria when there's different levels of ability and thing. It's just crazy to me.
You know what? Because people always want an easy way out, where they think when you have a group of disabled people, just put them in one pot, or just put them in one group. It's not like that. Have a little bit of imagination.
Yeah.
Come on, guys. It is like, you know, it's like, just look at the world. We have people who have blue eyes, some are short, some are tall, some are visually impaired. we are also different, and that's what happens when it comes to disability also.
Yeah,
you can never just sort of want to put people, you know, in one box. It's like,
no,
when someone with a disability comes to you and they want to try sport, at least learn about it, you know. And I think if coaches and clubs are becoming lazy to learn about this, then I think people need to take a responsibility to educate them. Someone needs to stand somewhere and say that we want to roll out, you know, some kind of a teaching program where people will be, you know.
No, definitely. I think that'd be really, really helpful. And then if people then have the right attitude, and then people feel more comfortable approaching clubs. Because I think, you know, there's a lot of, like you're saying, with the person with cerebral palsy having to do that run, there's probably a lot of horror stories out there that put people off from applying to any clubs or groups because they just don't think that they'll be understood. So it is,
you are right. And then, you know, but you know, also the funny thing is some coaches are just afraid because they don't know anything about disability, and some of them have never been exposed, you know, they've never even interacted with a disabled person. They don't have a disabled person in the family or a close friend. So you take this person with cerebral palsy with spasms and stuff like that, and they're just like, oh my god, this person is going to die on me, you know. And they're so afraid even to do the basics with them. But also, it also starts with schools. Also, one thing, you know, that I would really, you know, maybe if PE was something that was, you know, like disabled children should not be left behind.
Yeah, I think, you know, it's a problem. I think I remember when I was at school, it was never, like, the people with, like, some sort of, like, mobility disabilities, they were, like, separated from the main group as well and didn't get to do as much as everyone else.
Yeah, I've had disabled friends who've told me when they were in school, when other people were doing PE, what they did was just to go and throw, you know, bean bags and, you know, stuff like that. You know, it's like they were cushioned, and, you know.
Yeah, you do need to, like, start from, if you're educated about it from a young age, I think it just kind of needs to happen for everyone to, like, learn more about disability in general and how to, like, respect and interact with their disabled peers as well.
Exactly. No, exactly. Yeah, yeah. And I think it brings me now to inclusion, because I am so big on inclusion.
Yes.
I am big on access and inclusion. And I think, to me, what I think is clubs need to be accessible so that disabled people can go in and train. Gyms and, you know, training facilities, you know.
Yeah.
Sporting facilities need to be accessible. When I say accessible, it's not having a key to open it. But, it is being accessible as in a disabled person or people with different disabilities can access those facilities.
Yeah. No, there is a few issues. I remember a few people I've interviewed, I was talking to them about their experiences with the gyms. And the lift, like wheelchair lifts, they're often like just hidden out of view and they can't always even find where they are when they're trying to get to different areas of the gym. It's just very kind of pushed out the way in some places, which is not good.
Yeah, and sometimes, you know, some facilities, when you go and you have a disability, they're like, oh, we cannot sort of, you can't use this facility because your wheelchair is a hazard. Somebody told me that they were told that in one of the gyms, and I was like, really? And you just went quietly? Because I wouldn't. No. I would chain myself there.
Yeah, like, how is it a hazard? That's so stupid.
Yeah. People need help. People need help. But also, I think people need to accept that they need help.
Yeah, that's another thing. That is an entirely thing.
Yeah.
Well, this was really, really great. And I really enjoyed talking to you about all of this.
We'll speak on LinkedIn, yeah?
Yeah.
Okay. See you.
See you.
Bye.